Welcome to our European edition of the 2021 International Orangutan Day event. Hello to everyone here in Europe and around the world watching this. My name is Ben Callison and I am your host. Before we get started, I want to give you a brief overview of the work of the Bornean Orangutan Survival Network. The BOS Foundation was formed exactly 30 years ago to combat the ever-decreasing amount of Bornean orangutans and lush rainforest in Indonesia. Through these past 30 years, the BOS Foundation, along with its global network of partners, have worked tirelessly to reverse this terrible trend. Our progress is truly unparalleled in the orangutan protection world, with thousands of orangutans cared for over our 30-year history. We currently have well over 400 orangutans in our care, almost 500 orphaned and rescued orangutans released back to the wild, and over 1.1 million acres of prime orangutan rainforest under our management. It's mind-boggling. Our network is made up of six partner BOS Foundation organizations. So here in Europe, we have BOS UK, which I lead, BOS Switzerland, BOS Germany, and Save the Orangutan, which is located in Denmark, Sweden, and also here in the UK. Outside of Europe, we have our partner organization, BOS Foundation, located in Indonesia, where the orangutans are. We also have BOS Australia and the newly formed BOS USA, which we're very excited about. I will now turn it over to each of the European CEOs for a brief introductory message.
Es freut mich ganz besonders, Sie im Namen von BOS Schweiz begrüßen zu dürfen. Es wartet ein spannendes Programm auf Sie mit Eindrücken aus den Rettungsstationen, aber auch Experteninterviews. Ein Teil unserer Beiträge heute beschäftigt sich angesichts der Corona-Pandemie mit tierärztlichen Fragen. Die Pandemie kam aus der Wildnis. Sie hat nun das Potenzial, vom Menschen zurück auf Wildtiere wie Orang-Utans übertragen zu werden. Mit dieser Problematik kämpfen auch diejenigen Orang-Utans, die BOS aus dem Wildtiertourismus gerettet hat. Aufgrund des zu engen Kontaktes mit Menschen sind sie oft mit ansteckenden und gefährlichen Krankheiten wie Hepatitis oder Tuberkulose infiziert. Es freut mich ganz besonders, dass im zweiten Programmteil heute ein Projekt Platz gefunden hat, das BOS Schweiz vor 3 Jahren initiierte. 2019 reiste ich mit Tierfilmern in die BOS-Rettungsstationen, um das Schicksal der aus der Tourismusindustrie geretteten Tiere zu beleuchten. Es würde mich sehr freuen, Sie heute mit auf diese Reise nehmen zu dürfen. Ich bedanke mich ganz herzlich, dass Sie sich die Zeit nehmen, sich mit unserem Anliegen auseinanderzusetzen, und wünsche Ihnen eine spannende Unterhaltung. Dankeschön.
Liebe Orang-Utan-Freunde, herzlich willkommen zum heutigen Welt-Orang-Utan-Tag 2021. Mein Name ist Daniel Merles, ich bin Geschäftsführer von BOS Deutschland e.V. und ich freue mich riesig über die große Unterstützung und das große Interesse an der heutigen Veranstaltung. Zur heutigen Veranstaltung muss ich aber sagen, wir sind international ausgerichtet. Wir haben sie zusammen mit unseren Partnern überall auf der Welt geplant und wir führen sie auch gemeinsam durch. Das heißt, sie wird in Englisch durchgeführt. Da bitte ich um Verständnis. Wir werden aber alle eure und ihre Fragen beantworten. Auf allen Kanälen können sie an uns gerichtet werden und in Absprache mit den Referentinnen hoffen wir können sie auch beantworten und werden nächste Woche auf unserer Website es veröffentlichen. Bleibt mir noch viel Freude beim Zuhören zu wünschen und mich für die große Unterstützung auch in diesem Jahr zu bedanken. Gerade in schwierigen Zeiten wie diesen in Deutschland und Indonesien freut mich das besonders. Vielen Dank.
Hi everyone, I'm Henny Gürtler and I'm joining you from Copenhagen. On behalf of Save the Orangutan in Denmark, Sweden and the UK, I warmly welcome our supporters and followers that are joining us on this International Orangutan Day. We'd like to put focus on the critical endangered orangutan and our joint efforts to save this beautiful species. Hey and welcome. På vegne af Red Orangutan i Danmark og Save the Orangutan i Sverige, ønsker jeg alle vores svenske og danske støtter og følgere velkommen til International Orangutan Day, hvor vi vil sætte fokus på den kritisk truede orangutan og vores fælles arbejde for at redde den fantastiske art. I hope you will all enjoy our events in company with our partners and of course the orangutans. Jeg håber, at I alle vil have glæde af vores arrangement, hvor I sammen med vores partnere og rapportererne vil få forhåbentlig en god oplevelse. Thank you for your support, og tak for jeres støtte. God fornøjelse.
It is a true honor to work alongside each of those CEOs. And now I get the esteemed honor of introducing someone that I have great respect for as well. And that is Dr. Jamartin Sahiti, CEO of the Boss Foundation.
Hello and welcome everyone. Thank you all for joining us today for this special event. I'm Dr. Jamartin Sahiti, the CEO of the Boss Foundation, and I'm so glad that you are here with us today. Whether you are one of our neighbors here in Indonesia, one of our friends from Australia, or an orangutan supporters from anywhere else in the world. Today, we celebrate our great 8,000, the orangutans, and the ways that they are essential to the heart of our ecosystem. They deserve our respect. They deserve to get protection. And that is exactly what we have been fighting for the past 3 decades. 2021 marks the 30 years anniversary of our work at the Boss Foundation. I've been fortunate to be part of this amazing organization and to lead such a wonderful team of dedicated orangutan warriors who have been persistently working to make a difference. Our team is made up of experts in orangutan welfare, management, and conservation. And together, we spend more than 30 years protecting these critically endangered species and their precious forest habitat. We do this by rescuing them from the area of human-wildlife conflict, providing sanctuary for rehabilitation, and reintroducing them back to the wild forest, all the while working together with local communities and conserving tropical ecosystem. This has never been about just one person acting alone. It is about all the people who are passionate about making a difference, coming together and taking action. It is about the hero and heroines who choose every day to dedicate their lives to save orangutan. I've seen their optimism, their unbreakable will, their hope. It is why I joined this organization, to be a voice for these dedicated people and the animals they deeply care for, the orangutan. And day in and day out, my team and I do our part to conserve these incredible animals. But for all of us, no matter where we are in the world, these have been incredibly trying times. The COVID-19 pandemic has threatened much of what we hold, my dear. And it's hard to focus on the things we normally prioritize. For the safety of our orangutans and of our employees, we decided to close our facility temporarily in March last year. But our staff continue to preserve because we have over 400 orangutans, and they rely on us for food and care every single day. However, the health and safety of the animals in our care remains our top priority, and our team members have been working day and night with the utmost determination to protect the orangutans in our care from this virus. We are confident that we will, as an organization, emerge stronger as this is exactly what our anniversary is about, acknowledging and celebrating the fact that we are stronger together. That is why I'm so grateful for all of you choosing to be part of the BOS family. Before we get started, I'd like to express my gratitude to all of you who so generously support us to run our programs. We couldn't have done it without you. You have all chosen to be part of our event today because of our shared passion for serving orangutan. Your passion helps us to come together and inspire us to continue working together to overcome this crisis so we can stay on the front lines of conservation for the years to come. During the next 3 hours, you'll be getting to know more about the challenges we tackle and why orangutan are such a unique and important species. I hope that this will prove to be memorable and fulfilling for you. Thank you.
Right, so let's start our first session. And this first session is about a topic we get asked a lot. And that is about the journey towards freedom that our orangutans go through. So they go through a very extensive process when an orphaned or rescued orangutan comes to us. And the goal always is to get that orangutan back to the wild if possible. And we go through exhaustive measures to do that. So if we can get an orangutan back to the wild, we can not only protect the orangutan species long-term, but we can protect the rainforest and all the other species that rely on that same rainforest. They are the gardeners of the rainforest, and so they are so critical to the ecosystem in Indonesia. So for this reason, we wanted to put this talk together with a couple of our incredible staff that oversee this process. It's a very complicated process. It can take many, many years. And we get asked a lot of questions about why is this orangutan not going to a pre-release island, or when will they go, or why do they need socialization first? And when is their day to go back to the wild? So this talk will go over those kind of items. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to two of our wonderful staff at BOS Foundation, and I won't say their full names, otherwise I will do them a disservice. But that will be Dr. Arga and Dr. Agnes. So over to them.
For the past 30 years, the BOS Foundation has rescued thousands of orangutans and released hundreds of them in safe forests. Since 2012 alone, we have reintroduced 485 orangutans into their natural habitat, where they are thriving and establishing new wild populations, which also helps to bolster the conservation prospects for the species as a whole. The ultimate goal is freedom for each and every eligible orangutan in our care. But the journey toward freedom is not an easy one. Every orangutan's journey is unique and presents challenging obstacles that must be overcome. Every journey begins with a tragedy. And oftentimes, the orangutans lose not only their homes, but also their mothers.
Jadi kita datang ke sana dengan membawa beberapa tim seperti tim medis, kemudian juga BKSTA, dan orangutan ini kabarnya mau diserahkan oleh warga. Ketika kami menyelamatkan orangutan, tidak setiap kali laporan itu lengkap. Harus selalu siap dengan kondisi apapun. Kita tahu informasi ini jelas karena kita mendapatkan foto dari pemilik. Kalau di gambar ini ya, orangutan ini masih bayi.
Ya, Oh iya ya, kita pakai ini Pak ya, pakai mobil di pasar gitu Pak. Posisinya. Oke, okay, siap-siap. Kita nunggu di sini. Di pasar katanya nunggu.
Jadi kita standby di sini.
Standby di sini dia yang datang. Oh, ini bapaknya. Pak. Pak Jaya. Oh iya.
Dia ini siapa?
Yang pelapor.
Ya. Tapi bukan pemilik.
Kita belum tahu. Intinya dia yang melaporkan atau posisi orang utannya di mana, nanti kita ke lokasi aja.
Permisi untuk boleh makan.
Oh, boleh, silakan.
Oh, Bapak yang bekerja yang di Tahura.
Iya, di Tahura.
Di dinasnya, dinas sini kan?
Iya,
dinas kehutanan kan. Jadi dapatnya itu
dari masyarakat.
Dari masyarakat.
Kebetulan beliau itu yang menyerahkan, ya, kenal sama beliau, Bapak ya.
Iya.
Dan memang mau menyerahkan.
Memang mau menyerahkan.
Kalau dengan Bapak itu udah berapa lama?
Baru 4 hari ini.
Baru 4 hari ini.
Iya, 4 hari ini.
Kalau posisi ditemukan di mana?
Di Kurun Seberang.
Kurun Seberang desa.
Ya, masih Kurun di seberang. Oh,
di hutan ya. Itu ya. Sedang apa?
Nah, kurang tahu juga rasanya lagi
belum
nyantar pasir.
Ya. Tapi memang ada dekatan sama perkebunan kelapa sawit atau apa?
Ada.
Ada juga. Kebetulan
ada. Induknya lari kayaknya, itu jatuh dari induknya. Yang pasti posisi dia dapat itu jatuh katanya.
Oh.
Induknya lari.
Setiap hari makan apa, Pak?
Susu
di sini.
Susu. Iya, susu.
Kita bisa lihat ini, Pak?
Oh, boleh.
Kandang kan ada itu.
Iya. Mana?
Itu mau dibegendong pasti anu pasti leket terus.
Leket.
Ada batuk-batuk pang itu.
Ada batuk. Oh, harus sangat lah anu.
Dijamin jadi
lapor. Lepas.
Tapi dari kulitnya ini dia enggak dehidrasi, jadi tidak perlu diinfus. Jadi ya, alhamdulillah dia dalam keadaan sehat. Gimana ada giginya ini? Umur sekitar 6 bulan. Jenis kelamin betina.
Ya. Dan sehat selalu. Ya. Mungkin nanti kalau ada lagi yang menyerahkan, ada lagi menghubungi. Ya.
Ada dalam satu keluarga itu ada flu, pasti dia ikut flu.
Kayak gini yang pasti, yang penting memastikan dia tetap hangat. Ya, susunya kan pasti ada vitamin mineralnya segala macam yang cukup kan.
Ini masih bingung tempat baru.
Iya, di mana ya aku katanya.
Because when the infant orangutan comes to our center, it's mean that the orangutan already lost their mother, right? So if you can get one orangutan, it's mean like 5 orangutans already died, something like that. So it's so heartbreaking for me.
Usually, most of the rescued orangutans we got have previously been kept as pets, this can really affect their mental state and behavior. And sometimes the orangutans have been fed on human foods and drinks, and when they are rescued, they refuse to eat their natural fruit diet. So it takes time for the orangutans to adapt to the new diet and new lifestyle here.
Bring back their confidence at the first time is really important, because when the infant lost their parent, it means their immune system is really dropped. They will become really stressful and really easy to get sick. And somehow, if we are just too late to save them, yeah, they will pass away, something like that. We have to save them really the right time and the right moment.
The youngest orangutans join the nursery group, while juveniles are placed in forest school. Throughout their rehabilitation journey, young orphans are taught the skills they will need to survive in the wild and are stimulated to express their natural behaviors.
The first thing that we need to teach them is to bring back their confidence. Once their confidence is building up, they will easily to adapt. They will easily to adapt in the forest school, because they have lost their mother since the very beginning, so they have learned nothing from. They have learned nothing but only human behavior. So that's the biggest obstacle that we encounter at this stage.
Once juvenile orangutans become proficient in all necessary skills, they are placed in groups and moved to a socialization complex, where they are temporarily housed in large enclosures.
Orangutans are classed as a semi-solitary animals. They need to learn, but they need to learn socialization skills as well, because we have to put them with many other orphans.
Orangutan will learn a huge of things from their peers through play or observation. In the high trees, making that it's vital part of rehabilitation. I think without socialization, orangutan would not be fully equipped to survive in the wild.
An orangutan's survival skills are put to the final test when they are moved to a forested pre-release island.
The biggest challenge the orangutan will face in the pre-release island, yeah, they will have the real competition in the island with less attention from the keeper.
Every day, teams of technicians provide supplementary food and assess the overall well-being of orangutans on pre-release islands, while also collecting vital behavioral data.
So once they report there's something wrong with the orangutan, we can just go directly to go to island and check them. And we will also go to island like once a week at least, just to conduct a routine health check. And somehow we give regularly like a deworming every 1 until 3 months. Yeah, we give regularly deworming. So yeah, I think we still cover all the health check for the orangutan in pre-release island.
Once orangutans have proven themselves to be capable foragers, adept climbers, innovative nest builders, and appropriately wary of humans, they are deemed ready to return to a true wild forest.
Thank you.
the transportation, we have to minimize the stress for the orangutan during transportation. Yeah, we always give, we always do the routine check every 2 hours and give their favorite and extraordinary fruit to them.
There are many things we can do to reduce orangutan stress. For instance, in the transport cage, we give leaves to play with inside the cage, and also plenty food for along the journey. Also, we put leaves on the top and then around the cage, around the transport cage, to limit how much the unfamiliar surroundings the orangutan see along the journey. So I think this helps to keep them calm a little bit.
But the one thing that it will be helpful is just talk to them heart from heart to heart. So reassuring them that they are returning their home, and their true home is mean where they are free from kids and boundaries. So they will understand and it will make them calm. Just talk with them from heart to heart. The release of the orangutan is ultimate goal for every rehabilitation process. It is amazing moment for all of us, because we know exactly that they have gone from being kept as a pet since very young age and experienced a traumatic life and then mistreatment from the human, from the cruel human, and undergo a long process, rehabilitation process. So after they go release, it's just like amazing moment. Actually, it's speechless. You can't tell about it, because that's the ultimate goal for all of us. Just like, oh my god, this orangutan, I know this orangutan since first I work here, and then now he or she go to the forest and then just enjoy the fruit forest and then just climb and foraging the tree, do the tree's way, and then eat the park and cambium and everything, just like, and healthy and somehow copulate with others, just like copulate, and it's like, oh my god, it's just like, It's like magnificent feeling or tremendously amazing for me.
After release, life begins anew for these orangutans, who are free again to live their lives unencumbered by men. Still, our post-release monitoring team follows them regularly from a distance to collect valuable behavioral data regarding their adjustment to life in the wild and to intervene if they fail to adapt, become injured, or fall ill.
Because we do the heart release, it means there's no food after we open the cage. So that's the greatest challenge, I think, for them.
Orangutans have to adapt with their new environment and then explore to find food and protect themselves, like climbing in the trees and make a nest to sleep in. To make this process easier for the orangutans, we try to release small groups of orangutans who are familiar or friends with each other at the same time. And also we release them close to each other so they can find other if they need to. Normally we find that less confident orangutan will follow a more confident orangutan therefore the first few days eating the same foods, making nests next to each other or even in the same trees. So I think after this initial period of adaptation, the orangutans will separate and become solitary.
But even though that we don't give a food, but the monitor team still follow them from distance to collect the valuable behavior data regarding their adjustment to life in the wild. So only when really, really necessary. So this could be situation like where we need to perform emergency procedure if they become severely injured or fall sick, or if the orangutan just fail to adapt, something like that. But this decision is not easy. This decision is made based on discussion all of the stakeholders with the vet and the management in release, and then also management in Nyaru Menteng. Roughly, our survival rate is greater than 70%. So that's quite high for rehabilitation orangutan.
With the support of orangutan warriors like yourself, we try to make the journey of every orangutan end with a wild and secure future for them and for their forest homes.
Well, we hope you enjoyed that talk. Fascinating information every time I hear it. And it is such a complex process, as you can imagine, to get these orangutans from little tiny orphans or rescued all the way through the education process, the verification process, and the very complex process of transporting them back to the wild. And now we're going to lighten the mood a little bit. For those of you that have seen our hit TV show, Orangutan Jungle School, you're in for a treat. For those of you that don't know about Orangutan Jungle School, you can go to orangutanjungleschool.com and hopefully it airs in your country. There's a little drop down for your country so you can catch up. We have 2 seasons so far and a third in the works. More on that in the coming, hopefully, weeks and months. But here we have a few clips that we got from the makers of OJS, Orangutan Jungle School. They wanted to share some never before seen footage from their filming of Orangutan Jungle School. So enjoy.
He is a fat orangutan and he need diet.
Please don't give Benny any milk at all.
Benny nanti potongan Benny.
Stage is he at?
Yeah, actually, our Benny is here. Yeah. It's flirting.
What did he just do?
Yeah, it's just flirting, like, just in front of me. Can you smell it?
Yes.
As long as you're happy, yeah, son? Dadah, Benny. Because they have food. That's why you go there, because they have food. You don't want to miss the party. Oh, Benny.
Silly Benny, Spunky Chinta, and oh, sweet Copperl, what a trio. When Copperl arrived, it was hard to believe he'd have quality of life, but to watch him learn, watch him heal, watch him grow as an orangutan and learn the skills necessary to climb trees and live near a wild existence on his new sanctuary island brings us all such hope. And hope really is the theme of the next topic. Of the next session. And that session is about this pandemic. Around the world, we're all facing this global pandemic together. It has touched every corner of the world. It's been raging for over a year, and it still unfortunately rages in Indonesia. For this reason, we felt that we should address this in our next session. So our next session is called Conservation in the Time of a Pandemic. And we have two wonderful speakers and a moderator next for you. And the speakers are Dr. Lauren Howard, the Associate Director of Veterinary Services for the San Diego Safari Park. And then Dr. Greggy Harry Puetra, our veterinarian from Boss Foundation. And moderating is Dr. Francisca Sulacicio, I hope I got that right, one of our veterinarian as well. So enjoy, and we'll be back afterwards.
Hello everyone, welcome to the online talk show presented by Boss Foundation and its partner organizations. This is a part of our public outreach programs in the event of this year's International Orangutans Day, August 19, 2021. Today we are going to talk about conservation in the time of a pandemic. The outbreak of COVID-19 changes life as we knew it by confronting communities around the world with novel public health and economic challenges. The new virus poses not only a threat to humans, but also to our great ape cousins, who have the very same receptor that is susceptible to SARS-CoV-2, the virus that manifests as COVID-19. However, conservation and animal care cannot be suspended and be moved to work from home. In this session, we will explore and compare the way captive care institutions reacted to the pandemic and continued to put the welfare of the great apes first. So joining us today are two wildlife vets from two opposite parts of the globe, but I believe they share the same heart and passions in what they're doing for the animals. The first speaker that I'd like to introduce is Dr. Lauren Howard, the Director of Veterinary Services at the San Diego Zoo Safari Park. She was first part of San Diego Zoo Wildlife Alliance in 2002 to 2004 as a zoological medicine resident, and then served as an associate veterinarian at the Houston Zoo for 12 years. Dr. Howard rejoined San Diego Zoo Wildlife Alliance in 2016 and leads the veterinary team in ensuring that the San Diego Zoo Wildlife Alliance animals thrive by providing world-class medical and preventive care. Dr. Howard is active in San Diego Zoo Wildlife Alliance's initiative to bring the northern white rhino back from extinction, and in situ and ex situ elephant health and disease with an emphasis on elephant herpes virus. So good morning to you, Lauren.
Good morning, thanks for having me.
So good to have you here with us. And the second speaker is one of our Boss Foundation vet. He is Dr. Greggy Puetra. Dr. Greg has been working at the Nyaru Menteng Orangutan Rehabilitation Center for 7 years now. He has extensive experience in caring for orangutans from the point of rescue to their reintroduction back to the forest, their natural home. In the Nyaru Menteng Center today, Greg is part of the team responsible for coordinating the COVID-19 prevention efforts for staff and orangutans. This includes everything from taking nasopharyngeal swab samples from both species and developing precautionary protocols and planning. So Greg, welcome to this event.
Hi everyone, thank you for having me too.
Thank you for being here. Hope you are doing fine, and so does the vet team in Nyaru Menteng and the orangutan. So I see that you are logging in from the clinic, is it?
Yes, that's correct. This is our clinic.
Nice.
Yeah.
So, and I will be your host today. My name is Siska. I had also worked at Boss Nyaru Menteng before and was an animal welfare coordinator for all programs at Boss Foundation. Today, I advise Orangutan Rescue Center across Indonesia and serve as the Southeast Asia representative for the Orangutan Veterinary Advisory Group, or OVAC. So, Lauren, when we're talking about COVID-19 in wildlife, I guess the gorilla case that happened in your institution in January this year is kind of the milestone as the first case of COVID-19 in great apes or even in primates outside laboratory, right? So it's kind of you know that in the past there are papers suggesting that theoretically great apes and other species can get COVID because they have the same receptors, and indeed gorillas can have it and they can be quite sick. So yeah, I've heard your story many times and it's amazing. I always enjoy to hear how you and the team kind of orchestrated the crisis management of the situation. So to get our audience today understand the context better, I believe you have some materials to share with us. Lauren, go ahead.
Thank you. Yes, thank you, Siska, for the opportunity. I'm just going to very briefly, through just a handful of slides, give everyone a background on what we experienced when our entire gorilla troop was exposed to and became symptomatic due to COVID-19 earlier this year. So just a little bit of background. San Diego Zoo Wildlife Alliance is a conservation center with two front doors. We have the San Diego Zoo, which is downtown near the coast and the airport. And then we have the San Diego Zoo Safari Park, which is where I'm based. And it is about 15 to 20 miles north of the downtown one. So these are two completely separate parks, but managed under the same conservation organization. And we have two completely separate collections and completely separate veterinary teams. At the Safari Park, we have a troop of eight gorillas. Those are the only apes we have at the Safari Park. Down at the zoo, they have orangutans, gorillas, and bonobos. And our gorilla troop at the San Diego Zoo Safari Park, as I mentioned, is an eight-member family group with a wide cross-section of ages. We have two geriatric animals, a silverback and a female. We have four young adults to adults, and then we have two juveniles. And like many of us all across the globe during the pandemic, we stepped up what's normal PPE from everyday pre-pandemic. And a lot of people have asked, well, what PPE were you wearing when your gorillas became ill from COVID? So that's why I included this slide. We have, at that point, we had daily medical screening of all of the staff entering park grounds, answering several questions about illnesses and exposures, and forehead temperatures taken on every employee. All of our employees who care for animals have dedicated uniforms and shoes that don't leave the property. We did have a foot bath at the entrance to the gorilla building. And in the gorilla building and working with the gorillas, keepers were expected to wear or required to wear surgical grade disposable face masks and gloves when working with the animals, and to wear safety goggles or face shield when cleaning. So that was our standard COVID PPE at the time in January when all of this started. And here's a timeline to kind of give you an idea. The story started December 30th when one of our animal care specialists fell off, left work immediately, and went to get COVID tested. The next day that individual did find out they were positive via nasal swab PCR and immediately let leadership at the park know. So the next day, we had all gorilla keepers start wearing N95 masks with the thought that if that would protect them from each other, if they were also exposed, and also potentially to prevent shedding or more shedding to the gorillas. And everything seemed fine for a few days. And then a few days after that, on January 6th, what we call day one, our silverback, our 47-year-old male, silverback started, was very lethargic and was found coughing that morning. And then later in the morning, our older female was also coughing. At that point, in addition to the N95s, we did have all the gorilla keepers start wearing face shields to protect them from any droplets that were being sprayed. The idea of having two gorillas coughing and a known potential COVID exposure did really elevate our suspicion for the gorillas being sick from COVID-19. The following day, the silverback was still coughing and lethargic. We had another male who began coughing. And that was when we decided to submit testing of the whole troop for SARS-CoV-2, the virus that caused coronavirus. Now, we did try, we talked about nasal swabs or something like that, but we were unable to really get any kind of good swabs as deep as you need to get a reliable sample. So we did end up submitting individual fecal samples. And the laboratory will tell you that fecal samples are not ideal. They're not nearly as good as a nasal swab, but they are pretty good. And especially early in disease, it does seem that fecal samples are pretty good when tested via PCR to pick up presence of the virus. The following day, our silverback was still not feeling very good. The female was coughing. And at the end of that day, we did get the PCR results from the laboratory that our gorillas were positive. And at that point, we had 8 gorillas. We were able to collect 7 fecals. And I believe 4 of them were confirmed positive on PCR. But we treated the entire troop as though they were positive because they were living in a family situation and sharing space in the building. Our gorilla continued to have lethargy, and another male started coughing that day. And the very next day after we got the results in the afternoon, we did start having the gorilla keepers start wearing Tyvek suits over their uniforms, in addition to the N95s, the gloves, the face shields, and the foot bath. And then the following day, we got a visit from the county health department, who helped us evaluate the PPE the gorilla keepers were wearing, and to greatly enhance that by training them in proper donning and doffing of PPE, setting up hot and cold zones to make sure that no contamination of that building left the site. So that was the snapshot of the first week. And a few days later, when the silverback, oh, here we go. So this is a 2 or 3 week snapshot of what happened in our troop. Overall, the clinical signs lasted about 3 weeks in the troop. And the darker squares indicate concerning signs. And that was, again, our older male and our older female. And then the lighter squares just show what kind of mild signs the rest of our gorillas had. So pretty much every gorilla in that time period had some degree of coughing, sneezing, nasal discharge, something, but nothing clinically concerning and nothing that required intervention other than our 2 oldest animals. And by January 25th, almost 3 weeks after the initial clinical sign, the troop was on the mend. And we were able to depend on some really great researchers here in San Diego to look at sequences of the gorilla strain and the strain of the animal care specialist, the keeper, that ended up being positive, and they were identical. So this is actually the first time we've been able to confirm the exact same COVID strain in an animal and a person. And it's a great indication of how amazing our county is in being able to track samples and do this kind of work. So we do know that the gorilla and the keeper were sharing the same virus. So as I mentioned, it was our 2 older animals that caused us concern, and our silverback was by far the sickest animal. And by the following Tuesday, so a week after his initial clinical signs, he was still very lethargic and had respiratory issues, and we elected to anesthetize him. We gowned up and complete what we call CDC level PPE to protect our staff. At this point, none of us were vaccinated, and our hospital facility has a closed circulation system where we knew our treatment area and exam area wouldn't spread out to the rest of the hospital. So we took a lot of training and interventions in a short time period to get ready for this exam. And these are all the treatments that we administered to that silverback gorilla when he was under anesthesia. We did administer monoclonal antibodies, which are a really great tool in COVID. They are designated for ambulatory human patients who are high risk due to comorbidities, but not in need of, dependent on oxygen or not in need of the hospital yet. The idea is to get these antibodies into the people early on in their disease process to help fight the virus so that they don't become a need for hospitalization. So that was a perfect use for our gorilla. We also gave him non-steroidals, antihistamine, antacids, antiemetics. We did start him on antibiotics, and we certainly gave him fluids while he was under as well. Now, Winston had probably mild heart disease beforehand that was not on treatment for. The primary findings during his exam was very low pulse oximetry, very low oxygen saturation, very productive, fluid-filled respiratory tract. We ended up having to suction fluid out of his trachea about every 5 minutes throughout the 2-hour procedure. The 2 severe concerning findings were a very severe ventricular arrhythmia, which we assume is due to myocarditis from the virus. And then he also had a pretty significant pneumonia. And we're fortunate to have a computed tomography, a CT machine in our building. So we were able to run a CT on him. And here you can see the infiltrates in his lungs that were designated by CT. He did recover well with all the treatments we administered. And this is an example, we did a recheck exam two months later. And you can see on the left side of the screen, you can see the infiltrates, and especially on the ventral, which is the dorsal side, the fluid. And then two months later, you can see how much that's cleared up. So he did make a really great recovery. He's still on a lot of cardiac medications for the arrhythmia and overall reduced cardiac function. But he is back with the troop and acting great. We're really pleased with his progress. So that is just a very quick summary of what happened from January to February here in San Diego. I'm happy to answer other questions that people have if there's more details. But that's the story.
Right. Thank you, Lauren. Very interesting. And I'm sure we have a lot of questions and discussions to talk about the cases. But first of all, I'm glad that the gorillas are now okay and they're doing fine. So that's very good news. And again, congratulations to your team for being able to handle them so finely. Can I ask you first, what do you think as the vet, the biggest challenge you faced during the treatment? What's the most challenging time or aspect when you do the treatment for Winston and other gorillas?
The first challenge was deciding if we needed to act. As you know, the most of the gorillas had a nasal discharge, but they were fine. And Winston, he's still an active silverback in a troop. He's actually, I think, the oldest silverback to still be with a family group. Mm-hmm. And there were some days where he looked very lethargic and other days where maybe he perked up. And we kept wondering, he's going to get through it just like everyone else, right? So that decision that, no, he's not and he needs our help, that was the first big challenge. And then it was all mental. It was, it makes me give so much kudos and props to the healthcare workers who work with COVID positive patients every day, because the ability to get our staff in the right mental place to know that we are going to bring a, you know, 400-pound feces covered coughing COVID positive gorilla into our building and work intimately with him for 2 hours to try to save his life, it was a lot. And we actually, the day before, we canceled all of our procedures and we practiced the whole procedure multiple times. We practiced donning and doffing. I think that gave folks a lot of confidence that we would be able to get through the procedure okay. So the mental part was definitely the hardest. You know, it's not easy to lug a gorilla around and get him into the CBT machine. So that was challenging too, but that's, you know, it's like Greg too, right? It's what you do when you're a veterinarian. Yeah. So that part was, once we were doing it was easy. It was the mental thing that was hard.
Yeah, I cannot imagine, and I'm really intrigued to know your anesthesia protocol for the gorilla, but maybe that's for another day.
It was all Tebazol. Yeah, we stay far away from the alpha 2s, which we're glad we did. So it was basically Tebazol and isoflurane. And he did have a slow recovery, but we expected that. So
yeah, it's better have a slow recovery than spontaneous arousal, right?
Yeah.
Greg, do you have any comments or questions about the gorilla while we are talking about the challenges of treating the very sick individual in Lauren's case?
Yeah, so I can agree that the moment when we have to decide that we need to do intervention to them is, it's quite challenging as well, especially when you know, you are dealing with such a big animal, and we all know that there are risks to do anesthesia and etc. So that's a quite big challenge. So, my question is, first, what kind of let's say observations or, you know, parameters that you used each day for those groups when they have a positive case, so then you can say that, oh yeah, okay, that's just if these kids are okay, or then you know, some groups that are not really well.
That's a great question, Greg, because we had the same. Communication was also a challenge. Because the gorillas were in the building, they were positive. We weren't going into the building, so it was all verbal communication from the keepers who were going into the building caring for them. And I can actually share this document. We can put it in maybe later, but we created a one-page document with all the gorillas' names, and based on the CDC website of the questions they asked, nasal discharge, lethargy, coughing, wheezing, we threw in appetite. We listed it on the side, and we just had yes, no every day. We made it really simple. Every day the keepers filled out one form as a summary of each animal. And that's how I could, that Excel sheet that I showed in my slides, that's how I could complete that so easily. And there's, you know, we have to complete an epidemiologic form for our government. And those pages really help go back and figure out who was coughing when. And if you look at, you know, Winston, he had yes, yes, yes. And we had some gradings like 1 to 5, and he was up at the 4s and 5s. So it was that information. But yeah, it's a really good point, like keeping track every day of who's doing what. That was a really helpful little document we put together.
That's very useful. Thanks, Lauren. And moving on to the case, have you seen any long-term effect of the virus on the group once they are considered healthy after the 3 weeks sickness? How are they doing nowadays?
The group is doing great. What I didn't talk about in the slides was Cammy, who's our, you know, older female. When we saw how sick Winston was during his exam, we got worried about Cammy. And we thought we need to do an exam on her. So we did Winston on a Tuesday. I think we did Cammy on that Saturday, same gear up and all that stuff. And she, other than being a little overweight and having some bad teeth, she was completely healthy. And in fact, when we did her nasal swab during her procedure that Saturday, it was negative at that point already. So we do know that we need to go back and work on her teeth at some point. But so the rest of the troop seemed fully recovered. We have done since then. So we did this all happened in January. We did a quick recheck on Winston in March, and then we did another exam on him. I think it was June. So he generally is actually, now that we're addressing his heart condition, he's almost more active than he was even before COVID. So we were able to identify probably some underlying cardiac conditions, decreased cardiac function that we're treating. So he actually we implanted a remote loop recorder over his heart so we can watch his rhythm from remotely. So we can monitor so the arrhythmia seems resolved and his respiratory signs seem resolved. We've been asked if about COVID, the long hauler situation, if we think our gorillas might have that. And we just don't have any way to know, but we haven't seen any instances that make us think they're in a fog or not paying attention or extremely lethargic. So they've been pretty normal.
Okay, great. Thank you. That's interesting information. And moving on, is there any other species of animals that get, I don't know, infected with COVID or suspected to get COVID as well in your institution? Any news to share besides the gorilla?
Yeah, so we've identified in our institution the species of concern are primates, felids, and mustelids, because of all the mink, obviously the mink worldwide that are having so much trouble. And in our, actually, you can find it in the news in the last few weeks. We did have 2 snow leopards that were diagnosed as positive for coronavirus at the San Diego Zoo. And those animals had mild clinical signs, not anything that required intervention, but we're watching closely for a little bit. And that's why they had fecal samples submitted. So they were diagnosed on fecal sample and were being monitored. Interestingly, they lived very close to 2 Amur leopards, and those animals were never diagnosed as positive. So it makes us wonder if there's like a species taxa predilection. And then here at the safari park, we do have our tiger troop. Our six Sumatran tigers are currently in the middle of a coronavirus episode where they are on the mend for the most part, but very similar to Winston. We had a 17-year-old tiger we knew had some kidney insufficiency that we've been watching very closely, and became this close to deciding to do an intervention on him.
Oh, wow.
But he kind of turned the corner at the last minute. And all those tigers were diagnosed via fecal PCR as well. So that the fecal PCR has been a really good tool for us if we have a case we're suspicious of. We're not doing any screening or anything like that. We're just focusing on trying to diagnose clinical cases. And really the importance in that is not even so much intervention for the animals, but it's to be able to provide the proper protection for the people caring for the animals and making sure that they have the right PPE on so they're not exposed. So that's been our drive, and wanted to make sure we know what's going on in our wildlife.
Right. Yeah, I think that's a very important point to raise, that testing is not just for the sake of the animal that are suspected, but more to prevent transmission to the rest of the population and visitors and the staff and etc. So thank you, and really, really sorry for the Sumatran tigers. I hope they will be okay soon. Last week in Indonesia, there was also a reported case of COVID in two Sumatran tiger. I guess that's the first wildlife reported with COVID in Indonesia, is that correct?
Yeah, that's the first case.
Okay. Now, I'm going to ask more about vaccination, Lauren, if you might. I understand that in San Diego Zoo Wildlife Alliance, you've been vaccinating some of the high concern species for COVID-19. Can you share the story about this? What are the reasons? How did it go so far?
Sure. And it's not just us, but we've been really happy to be able to part of the program. So Zoetis is an international veterinary company, and they've worked very hard to create a veterinary SARS-CoV-2 vaccine. So it's just labeled for animals. We did not even think about trying to take vaccines out of the human realm to use on our animals, because obviously it's more important that people are immunized. But now that we have the veterinary vaccine, it's been a great opportunity. So Zoetis has been a tremendous partner to zoos across the US, and I'm sure in other parts of the world as well, providing the vaccine. And it is tricky. It's just like the COVID vaccines. It needs to be kept at a very cold temperature. And once you open a bottle for 10 doses, it's only good for 24 hours. So it requires some planning. You know, you can't just do an animal here or there. So at the San Diego Zoo and the Safari Park, we've identified all of our primates, all of our mustelids, which we don't have too many, and our felids, which here at the Safari Park, that's our Sumatran tigers, our lion troop. We have over 30 cheetahs in a breeding situation. And then our smaller cats, black-footed cats, sand cats, ocelots. And then a couple of other carnivores, like our coati, are in an area where they do have a lot of guest exposure. So even though they're not mustelids, we figure they're worth protecting them as well. And then we have our domestic dogs that live with some of our cheetahs who are animal ambassadors. So we've actually vaccinated them too to just help protect our cheetahs. We've got all of our susceptible species got their first doses in already. And then it's a 3-week wait time and then the second dose. And we've started on our second round of doses. And down at the zoo, they have all those apes. They have the orangs, the bonobos, the gorillas, and a lot more primates than we do. So they probably have twice as many animals to vaccine, and they're also doing a great job. We felt a sense of urgency with just the increase in COVID cases over the last month. So, you know, it took a little while to get the vaccine, and during that time, there wasn't as much urgency. And now it's like, we gotta get these animals protected. We've seen very few, if any, vaccine adverse reactions. We're required to report those right away because the vaccine is still new. So far it's going really well. How well it will protect the animals is, we don't know that yet. Yeah. And as we're learning, you know, with the Delta variant, it's protection from illness, but not shedding. So that adds another layer. We don't know if it'll be the same way for the Zoetis vaccine.
Thank you.
That's very interesting. I guess one last question for you before I move to talk with Greg and discuss about the situation in Nyaru Menteng. Do you have any advice for the FAT teams in Indonesia from your experience responding to COVID-19?
I think your teams in Indonesia are amazing, and I know you guys are doing amazing work with probably not as many resources as you deserve. I think one thing we learned with the gorillas is how important ventilation is. And our gorilla building, we're in a fire zone, so our gorilla building actually has a device that would suck smoke out of the building if there was a fire. We were able to turn that on to greatly increase the ventilation in our building, and I'm just picturing it sucking all the viral particles right out. So when our gorillas were ill, we actually kept doors open to keep ventilation. In your housing situations, if there's ways to increase ventilation, that's always a great thing. And then the big thing we learned is you can't just give PPE to someone who's not medically trained and expect them to know exactly how to use it to stay safe. There's more to just putting a Tyvek suit on. It's where you put it on and where you take it off and what areas you go to and what things you don't do when you're in that situation. So training of people and practicing is a really important part of it too. And then just, you know, doing what you can and creating an index of suspicion for if it's a case, and then having a protocol for how to test it. Mm.
Interesting. I'm making notes here. Thank you. Thank you, Lauren. Now moving to Greg, and I'm happy to you, Lauren, to jump into the discussion because we want it to be like an active talk. Greg, can you share to us the measures that you and the BOS team has put in place to protect orangutans in rehab centers against COVID-19?
Yes, sure. I'm happy to share to everyone about this. So we kind of defined two measures from human perspective and from animal perspective. So the way of thinking that if we can protect our staff, the humans, from COVID, then our animals won't get the same thing too. So we start with making a physical restrictions to all our centers, and we start to continue to do monthly COVID screenings to our staff. And then to make sure that certain areas from our centers is considerably to be safe, especially to because our staff, about 80 to 90% of our staff are local people, so we want to make sure that the places around our centers is also considered to be safe. So we also gather local people to get the same understandings about how important to keep ourselves safe from COVID, and then we help local people to do a monthly or periodic surveillance about COVID. So we kind of give them a rapid test for people to use. Then we kind of get the idea of what exactly going on around our centers. And from the orangutan perspective, we also do COVID screenings to all of our orangutans for several purposes. And if some staff got positive cases or suspected from COVID case, then we also do tracing to our orangutans, and we do COVID tests to them as well. And all of the things won't be happened if we don't form SATGAS or COVID committee.
Task force.
SATGAS COVID committee at all.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, so those things won't be happened if we don't have committed at our centers, and that's the key point to do most of the things. Yes, I think that's
Very interesting. So the way I see it, that you first focusing the prevention on the human first as a source of infection. Yeah, so you try to protect your staff and including the local communities as well. Get them under surveillance. I mean, help them with getting screening tests and other measures, so that by protecting the local community, you are protecting the animal. I think that's a really good concept. Now, with the orangutans at POS Foundation, are there any particular groups that you see at having a high risk of getting COVID in rehab centers, either in Nyaro Menteng or in Samboja, based on your knowledge?
Yeah, sure. So groups that are having access to forest school and having access to, you know, get contact with staff, for instance, orangutans that are going to the forest school with babysitters or orangutan technicians. Every day there are groups that is having the highest risk to get COVID transmission from humans. So the other groups like orangutans from Faroese Islands, for instance, are having a lower chance to get infected, because people are just, you know, having enough distance or even far away distance to, you know, just have throw fruit and everything and do observation from distance. So orangutans from islands are not having that kind of a big risk compared to orangutans from forest school.
Oh, I see.
And orangutans in the cages as well. Orangutan at the cage. Yes.
Right. So you're saying that those that are of high risk orangutans that are in the forest school stage, and for the audience, that forest school in Bost Foundation and most other rehab centers in Indonesia is kind of a place where orangutans and human are kind of mingled or stay in the same environment. So that's why you think they are at high risk, because they're having a very close contact with human or the caretakers, yeah. Right, Greg?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Those that you think are of lower risk are those that are on the pre-release islands. So those who are already have very limited contact with the caretakers.
Yes.
And as well as those who are in the cage. And what about, like Lauren mentioned, that based on the case in the gorilla, the elderly ones get really sick. Are you concerned about the older orangutans that you care for? Or those who probably has a comorbidity like we see in human population?
Actually, I forgot to ask that question to Lauren, but I will want to know that later.
Do ask her.
Besides all the age aspect, we also are looking for the comorbid, like you said, especially when it comes to respiratory problem history that they have in the past. So we kind of make a note which orangutan that has this kind of problems in the past. Then besides, of course, we are, you know, watching all of orangutans, but we kind of have, special notification for those kind of groups. But so far, there are no, you know, big changes or big impact that we have for those groups.
So your question is, can you summarize, Greg?
No, so oh, for sorry. no No, I'm,
oh, this
no,
is
I'm,
answering I'm, my I'm, question, right?
Yes, I'm answering you. Yes, I'm answering. So probably the same questions to you, Lauren. And I don't know if it, if I'm allowed to now. I
sure.
ask the same questions to you. Yeah. So you said before about the age differences that might have you know, different severity to your gorillas, but do those individuals have you know, kind of respiratory problems in the past that you think it might affect their severity, or you know, is there already such a thing? Or?
Well, fortunately, our gorillas that in our troop don't have any history of respiratory disease. So it's just Winston with his, you know, he's a 49-year-old silverback, so some degree of cardiac. But it, what was interesting, I'm glad you brought this up because I forgot to mention it, is we have two young males that are just kind of becoming silverbacks. So they're at a pretty stressful time in their lives. And they were, after our older two, our silverback and our grandma, they were the next group that were most affected. They didn't require intervention, but they had a few days where they were pretty lethargic. So I wonder if, you know, social status is also something to consider if they're in that kind of stressy period where they're part of the troop, but they're not part of the troop, and they want to act tough, but they want their mom, you know, that kind of thing. If that that was something for us that, whereas like the 30-year-old ladies were fine. They coughed a couple of times and were good to go. So yeah, I think, and then our grandma, her most biggest comorbidity was obesity. And you hear a lot in the news about how that's a significant comorbidity, but in her case, it didn't end up causing her problems, but that was definitely a concern for us.
Okay.
Right, so better watch the orangutans, yeah?
Yes.
From obesity and other diseases. And then Greg, so you mentioned that you do screen tests orangutans for COVID. How do you do it?
So we have antigen test, and the gold standard is the thing is that we do the PCR test using nasopharynx swab and oropharynx swab, but also at the same time we also do an antigen test. So it's kind of like for antigen test, just nasopharynx swab, not oropharynx swab. Right. Yeah, but at the same day, so you kind of do like two things at almost the same time because they are under anesthetized. So, but for the antigen test, it's kind of a bit like because up until today, like we kind of not really sure about you know, how this antigen test will, you know, give us a better results or anything, you know, to determine COVID-19 or whatever in orangutans. So it's kind of the reason why we do rapid test antigen is just to, if we get positive results or negative results, then we kind of know, you know, the validity of this kit by watching the result of the PCR test. But the gold standard is still the PCR test.
Right.
And did you say they were anesthetized samples, not voluntary?
For younger, for the kids, we can just handle them. But for bigger orangutans, no.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you test the orangutans based on if they had a history of being in contact with any keepers or caretakers who are positive with COVID, and so it's kind of screening. So you test a lot of orangutans, and you use antigen rapid test, but the gold standard is still PCR.
Yes, and also plus we watch for the clinical signs that might, you know, appear.
Mm-hmm.
And then we also determined about the the time of the best time that when we need to take the samples. So we kind of like doing, you know, tracing from what is the last time they have contact with the positive results from staff, and then we kind of like, you know, doing all then three days after that, and then we do, you know, serial. But if we do anesthetized things because of the animal welfare reasons, or so we just have to do it once for all, and we, you know, send the samples.
Interesting. And now that we heard the story from San Diego Zoo that they use fecal sample to do PCR tests, will you consider that? And is it applicable to be done in Indonesia, to the best of your knowledge?
Yes. For the fecal sample test, that's, I think that's very favorable when we need to, you know, kind of know a surveillance for our populations, because, you know, we have like several orangutans from the same cage. So we kind of, because it's easier to take, you know, fecal samples than to, you know, swab test. So by, you know, by doing that, then I think we kind of know the overall conditions of what happens inside the centers. And I think that's applicable also, yeah. We can do like sampling, or, you know, is that also the San Diego Zoo do? Like, you do samplings every month or every, you know, is there a timeline to do the screenings for all the animals?
So our cases, like our snow leopards, our gorillas, and our tigers, we are doing twice weekly fecals to try to understand when the viral load goes down in their feces, to help us understand when we can step down our PPE and also when we can allow the habitat to be open to the public again. So we do screening that way, but in our situation, we aren't screening animals that aren't clinically ill. And in your situation, I could see how valuable that would be, if, you know, to know that you have, you know, animals in your rehab situation that are positive, so you can act accordingly. In our situation, we don't have our lab doesn't have the capacity, and we don't have the strategy to screen all of our potentially susceptible animals. Now, the interesting question, I think your strategy for testing animals that might have been with a positive, you know, keeper or trainer, that's a really good one that we'll have to talk about here. It hasn't happened yet, but if in the future, if we found out a person caring for an animal was positive, would we wait for that animal to look sick, or would we start screening them like you're talking about? That's definitely something we'll talk about here.
Yeah,
interesting.
So we can, yeah, so we kind of make like we adopt the rules of when the best time that we take the samples. We adopt it from a human health perspective, so we kind of like adopt that and try to you know, use that to orangutans with, you know, kind of like adjusted stuff that we need to, you know, adjust, because we can't really, you know, adopt roughly from the human health perspective to all orangutans. But the principle is actually, if we do like antigen test, then at least we have to do it like serial, or like within 7 days or 10 days, and we have to do it like twice if the orangutans are not demanded to be anesthetized, or we can just handle them. But if, you know, if like we need to sedate them, then we can just do it once, like within 7 days or like 10 days after the contact. And we do not wait for them to be sick before we, you know, start to do the thing.
Yeah, I suppose that's important. Yes. Somewhere, how I see it, Bos Nyaru Menteng, Bos Samboja, and other orangutan rehabilitation centers, they house this single species in a very connected environment, and it's pretty much we're human and the orangutans or the great apes, they're sharing the same environment. So treating them as one population is basically, yeah, the concept of one health and how we can prevent disease transmission and make everyone in the environment healthy. Yeah. So yeah, and I can imagine how hard your work in Nyaru Menteng, Greg, you and your team doing screening for the staff, yeah, orangutans.
Like we have to put our eyes to like 300 orangutans. Around 300. Yeah. But we're okay. I'm fine.
We're okay.
We're okay.
That's why you wanted to do this panel, so we could sit down for 45 minutes.
Yes.
Right.
And yeah, could I mention some reasons why we need to screen the orangutans for COVID? Is actually other than just, you know, when they get close contact with positive stuff, but we also do COVID screening for new arrivals. We start to do that, and then we need to do this COVID screen test also for when we have to move the orangutans from the main area to Kurilis Islands. So transferring, you know, when we need to transfer them, so we have to check for the COVID again. And if the most important one is if we want to release them back to the forest.
Yeah, I suppose. that's the best strategy to keep the wild population stay away from COVID. So yeah. You do a lot of testing, and say you have a positive orangutan. Do you have a plan in place to care for them and manage the situation?
Yeah. So ever since March last year, so we have one facility which is located a bit separated with other facilities. So this facility is used to be a quarantine area for release candidates, but we are no longer using that for that purpose. So we switch that area to be prepared for isolation area. Mm-hmm. For those positive individuals that we might get in the future, which we hope that we won't use the area at all, so we can prepare the area. And then we have made strict protocols when you know, we are taking care of positive individuals.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, probably the big challenge also, that's why I asked Lauren a few minutes ago that what kind of parameters are we, you know, see from the positive individuals to make sure that, oh yeah, they are okay, they are not okay. So that probably will be a challenge for us as well.
Yeah.
Yes.
Interesting. Final question to Greg before we have to close this discussion. Although I'm sure there are many other questions that need to be discussed, but yeah. Anyway, the last question is for you, Greg, and this is representing your whole team in Nyaru Menteng. What have been the physical or emotional or even financial strains on the boss staff and orangutans in your care nowadays?
Well, we have, so for the physical strain, so we have faced some positive results from staff, so we have to quarantine them. They're mm-hmm. not allowed to work.
Mm-hmm.
So by then, all the people should replace their work. So that means there are overworked from, you know, from everywhere, from different divisions, which also affect their mental. And also for the orangutans as well, it's kind of sad for us. It's kind of heartbreaking because because of this adjust health protocols, we need to reduce their time to go to the forest school because we have to minimize the contact from animals to humans. And we divide people to be, you know, different groups. So we want to also make distance from every people, every group. So we are not like in one group, one big group, just like we are used to. So mm-hmm. that also affects our, you know, social, yeah. you know, social life as well. Then that kind of really reduced the number of how many people that, you know, working at the same time. So it really changed our somehow the mode of, yes, it really. And for the financials, well, you know, to do the screen test for humans, you know, for staff. And I've mentioned before that we helped local communities to do also a screen test that also quite, you know, requiring some money. And also we do like PCR tests for orangutans that also requires a lot of money because sadly when, you know, the tracing happens, sometimes you can get like 20 orangutans at the same time or like dozens of orangutans at the same time, and we need to perform a PCR test for those individuals, and that requires a lot of money. And you know, I think that's hard for everyone, but we, like I said, we are okay. No, I'm kidding, we are okay.
Okay,
it's been hard for everyone, but yeah, we have to do it
right. Yeah, okay. Thank you very much to both of you for sharing your stories, experience, and knowledge. I guess for us here, the panelists, this sharing kind of give us new insights of what's happening on the other side of the globe, what is happening here, how we can adjust, how we can use the experience to better up ourselves. So appreciate your participation in this. I guess we have to admit that this pandemic is indeed a very challenging, very difficult time for us. We are not just worrying about ourselves and our life, which already very heavy, but we also have to think about the animals that we care about. So many things that we don't know yet on the effect of COVID-19 to the animals, to great apes, to felines, to other species of wildlife, what could happen to them. But having this connection with other people, having this network, I suppose it helps a lot with sharing experience again and sharing knowledge. And I guess that's, we just have to do our best for now and hope that the pandemic will soon be over. Thank you very much again to Lauren. Have a good
everyone.
Day ahead for you. And yeah. Thank you to...
Have a good night, sleep for both of you.
Yes. Thank you to Greg for setting aside your midnight time to talk with us. Just want to say that you guys are doing amazing jobs. I'm sure this talk hopefully will inspire many more people to appreciate and be more involved in the conservation and of wildlife. So thank you. Happy International Orangutan Day, and goodbye, everyone.
Wow, a tough topic for sure. And I hope that gave everyone a sense of just how complicated it is to care for and protect orangutans and our staff during a pandemic like this, a pandemic that has raged for well over a year and is still very alive and well, sadly, in Indonesia. But we also want to say that our hearts go out to everyone around the world that has been affected and continues to be affected by this pandemic. We hear those stories all the time, losing loved ones, losing friends, losing jobs, all the other things that can happen because of a pandemic like this. And for that reason, we also want to thank every one of our supporters that has stood by us through this pandemic, because without you, we couldn't have continued. We wouldn't be able to provide the care and continue to provide the care that we do. So a huge thank you to all of you that have done that. A big thank you from the entire BOSS network. It means so much to us. And now we're going to transition to a different topic, a topic that focuses on a different threat to orangutans, and that is the wildlife trafficking trade. The wildlife trafficking trade is still very alive and well for orangutans and countless species, and it's something that we need to combat as a global community. And by doing so, we can finally put an end to it. So we were so proud, BOSS Switzerland was very proud to lead the effort in partnering with an incredible documentary filmmaker to put a focus on this issue in specific. And with that, the documentary Eyes of the Orangutan was born. This film has been a 4-year project to create, and it's incredible. And we do hope it's going to be the documentary that brings to the forefront this issue of wildlife trafficking in the entertainment industry for orangutans and finally puts an end to it. So you're going to get to see the trailer for it now, and stay afterwards because we're going to be speaking with Aaron Gakoski, the documentary filmmaker who created this with his team, and Dr. Sophia Benz with BOSS Switzerland, who has been leading this effort from the BOSS network. And after that, you'll be learning how to see the full documentary, which you're not going to want to miss. So stick around for that as well. So here's the trailer.
Photographers, we all have an opportunity to document and then to broadcast the truth. What we see and what we record can help change the world.
My name is Aaron Jakoski. I'm an environmental photojournalist. I've spent the past decade covering human-animal conflict around the world. But now I'm deep into the most important project I'll ever work on.
There's beatings and cruelty beyond belief and abuse that goes on behind the scenes that the tourists don't know about.
This is a wildlife house of horrors.
Everybody buying a ticket is responsible.
Traveling the world to enter the dark heart of the orangutan tourism industry.
He has an international network. Even some officials have been arrested within this case.
I had no idea where this would lead me and how big it would become.
The eyes of orangutan is coming before I go to bed, and it still remind me that I have to work harder and harder to let them out from the cages.
It's great to see that there actually is hope here.
This is the story of the wildlife tourism industry and its impact on one of our closest living relatives.
What a powerful documentary. Now that you've seen that, I'm now very excited for us to be joined by two very special guests. It's my honor to introduce you to Aaron Jakoski, an internationally acclaimed environmental photojournalist, filmmaker, and TV host. His work specializes in human-animal conflict, and also my dear friend and colleague, Dr. Sophia Benz, CEO of BOSS Switzerland, and the driving force behind BOSS's involvement working with Aaron on this groundbreaking documentary. So as you have just seen, the wildlife trafficking issue remains a huge threat to wildlife around the world, and orangutans are sadly no exception. So Aaron's award-winning work documenting the human wildlife conflict is why we knew he was the perfect partner to help us raise awareness of the illegal orangutan wildlife trafficking and entertainment industry. So this partnership culminated in the creation of the documentary you've just seen, Eyes of the Orangutan. So to tell you more about this incredible documentary, I now turn to my guests. So it's really great to see you both. So the first question is to you, Aaron. For our viewers, can you tell us a little bit more about the Eyes of the Orangutan documentary and why you felt this specific topic needed to be covered?
Yeah, thank you so much, Ben. And thank you for asking me to talk here today. I've been working as an environmental photojournalist for about 12 years now. And I started to investigate the wildlife tourism industry about 4 or 5 years ago. I was living in Asia, working here. And everywhere I went, I was seeing all of these examples of horrific wildlife tourism attractions, places where people can ride on elephants, where, you know, the most terrible zoos you've ever been to, places where orangutans are boxing each other. So I raised a little bit of funds and then spent a few weeks traveling around Thailand, which is very much the epicenter of the cruel wildlife tourism industry, and documenting what I saw. And from there, it just kind of exploded, really. And the images got so much attention. I mean, I was on BBC World News. It was all over the British press. And I think that people were so affected by it because everyone has been involved with the wildlife tourism industry at some point. We've all been to a zoo, we've all been to an aquarium, we've all seen animals perform at some point. So I think that this is one of those issues that kind of really touched everyone. And from there, because I've spent so much time documenting orangutans in the wild as a filmmaker and photographer, it was then that I started to really concentrate on orangutan tourism. And I think it had such an impact on me because you can really feel the animal suffering. We're talking here about one of the most intelligent creatures on Earth. And when you're at these wildlife tourism attractions, you can sense the sense of desperation, the despair, the depression. And then the more I learned about it, that was when I brought on some of my colleagues. And we decided to spend the next few years documenting the industry. And the more I learned, the worse it was. And from there, the project just grew. It took on a new life. And that was when we started working with BOS and also our other partners, Born Free Foundation and Jakarta Animal Aid Network. And here we are 4 years later with our project, Eyes of the Orangutan. And I just hope that the film will go some way to making people aware about some of the issues that orangutans face in captivity.
Mm. Right, it's such a powerful documentary. I have no doubt it will do that. And thank you so much for putting your lens to this issue. So now to Sophia. So why did you feel it was so important for BOSS Switzerland and the BOSS Network to support the production of this documentary? And from a personal note, why did you think this is such a special film?
Yes, thank you for the question. I think our work as BOSS organizations or conservation organizations in general oftentimes focuses on the cute and little baby orangutans because it's easy to generate funding through them and their stories. So the unreleasable animals, the adult ones, and that refers to the ones we rescued from these wildlife tourism attractions, they are oftentimes forgotten. It's more difficult to tell their story. So I really wanted to have their stories put in the focus of our work a little bit more than it is at the moment. And I think it's the documentary itself is special because it doesn't, because BOSS is in there, because it doesn't stop in Thailand in a rescue center. It stops where those orangutans actually should be in the ideal case in the rainforests in Indonesia. Only a few of them could be released. But that's one of the first things I told Aaron when we met. If you do that documentary, please make sure you don't stop the story in Thailand. It needs to continue to Indonesia. So that's one point. I also think it's special because it's not just informative. It's not just shocking and frustrating, telling what's really happening. It also gives people hope. And that's a big difference to other documentaries I've seen on that topic, because we really put emphasis on a clear call to action in the end, giving people the option to help and tell them how they can actually change the situation as those who go to these places, as the consumers of orangutan tourism, but also our supporters, introducing our campaigns and the kind of work we do, which really shows that as an individual we can make change here, and that's why I think it's special compared to other productions.
I do think sorry, just leading on from what Leah said, I do think that having that sense of hope was just so important in the film, because we are dealing with what is a very dark, very distressing industry when you start to do a little bit of digging. And we wouldn't have had a documentary if we hadn't have gone to BOS's facilities in Kalimantan, because we do need to know, people need something to, they need to know that there is, it's not all just doom and gloom, it's not terrible. You know, conservation has a very kind of negative association, particularly with broadcasters. But we wanted to show, look, there are these people who are actually dedicating their lives to try and mitigate some of the problems caused by the wildlife tourism industry.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And I feel personally that these orangutans that are part of the black market and this illegal wildlife trafficking are the forgotten orangutans in many ways. They get snuck out and they put into these facilities and their story gets lost. So this documentary finally puts a lens on this issue. So thank you. And actually, the next question back to you, Aaron. As we all just saw from the trailer, the documentary has some incredibly hard-hitting scenes. So what were some of the biggest challenges that you and your team faced in shooting this film?
Making a documentary like this is one big challenge. It is 4 years of challenges. I can't tell you how much effort, time, blood, sweat, and tears goes into making a film like this. The film spans several countries, so logistically it's a huge challenge, you know, to have the crew. We've also got a crew we were working on kind of bare bones budget as well. You know, documentaries like this are hugely expensive to produce, but you know, thankfully with our partners we were able to make it. But you know, still we had a crew who were working for free on the project. We also had what you see on screen is only 52 minutes, yet you don't see all of the pre-production, you don't see all of the the behind the scenes difficulties that you face when making editing something like this. You don't see the editing itself took like six months. So people think, I think sometimes like this industry and this career, people kind of think it's quite glamorous for some very strange reason. I'm telling you, like come and lead this life for a while and you'll see that it's not glamorous at all. Yeah. I think people kind of romanticize it. And then when actually people get into the industry and the business of wildlife and conservation filmmaking, they'll see just kind of how difficult it is. And, you know, myself, the crew, we've all had very, very difficult, very dark times kind of over the years. And that's just challenges that you face in this industry. And you know, you keep a bottle of whiskey on standby at all times. You keep your Prozac in another drawer and then you're good to go. But yeah, I think COVID was very good. It was an enforced break. We literally snuck filming in. We finished filming on the day of where everywhere went into lockdown. I got on the last flight home to Bali. So we really did just kind of manage to do it by the skin of our teeth.
Well, and a documentary like this, I mean, over that 1 hour, that 52 minutes, it's an emotional roller coaster, and it leaves you, it's a tough thing to watch, and it leaves you with that emotional baggage of seeing this issue. But that's 52 minutes. And I think everyone watching needs to understand that this is 4 years. Take that and magnify that over 4 years. It's just incredible that you guys are putting so much time and effort to this. And I can imagine that the compassion fatigue and everything is real. It is not.
It's real. And like, to be honest, now I'm like, I can hardly even watch it anymore. I'm just so, I just put so much into it, and I know the crew are all the same. We're just exhausted by it. But I would say that our partners, Terra Mater, who are the producers on the film, they've been absolutely fantastic, and they really breathed life into the project, particularly when maybe we felt kind of creatively we were hitting this kind of dead end. But they came on board, and working with Sue and Sabine has been absolutely amazing. And you know, the film was shown on Service TV. And then hopefully it's going to hit some of the major international broadcasters later this year. Well, that's the plan anyway.
Yeah, well, that's fantastic. We hope so. We need everyone to help support to make sure that happens. So back to you, Sophia. So in the documentary, we saw the journey of these orangutans, some of them that were back at our BOSS Center. So if you want to just give a little bit of an update on what's happened to the orangutans that BOSS rescued from the exact same wildlife entertainment industry in Thailand that Aaron and his team showcase in the documentary, and also why are orangutans rescued from these types of facilities so unlikely to be releasable back to the wild?
Mm-hmm. Yes, BOSS engaged in two rescues from Thailand in 2006 and 2016. So in total, we have taken in 52 orangutans from there. But we do have rescues from zoos and circuses within Indonesia as well. We do have some orangutans coming from Taiwan, from zoos there. So overall, I think it's more than 80 orangutans we do have with that kind of background in our facilities. For the 52 Thai orangutans, a number of them already died due to the diseases they are carrying because of the close interaction with humans. Many of them are infected with tuberculosis and hepatitis, for instance. And I think around 10 of them have already died. Of those who are still alive, we do have around one third who are already on pre-release islands and are prepared to be released after that many years, which up to 16 years. We have just released one of them with the first release after the lockdown by helicopter, Ninua, who is now back in the forest where she belongs. And it's still possible for those orangutans. Another third is has already been released. So those are the really lucky ones. And then there are, of course, many who are still in cages. And that's also one of the, I would say, the special, one of the special things about this documentary. It's also quite self-critical. You have seen BOSS and the role of BOSS bringing the hope to the documentary, but at the same time, we do show the orangutans, the unreleasable orangutans who are still in cages living with BOSS, who cannot be released, who are unreleasable because they are sick, because they have never been trained for the wild. And we do want to get them out of the cages. That's one of our big goals. So this is what we are fighting for, not just for the ex-Thai orangutans, but all the other unreleasable orangutans, of course, as well. Why it's difficult to release them back? Because many of them are sick, and we do not want to carry those viruses, of course, to the wild in order to protect the wild populations there. The other reason I've already mentioned as well, even if they would be okay to be released, many of them come at an old age. They have lived in cages. They have been locked up their entire life. And we cannot just release them because they wouldn't have any chance to survive. They have never learned how to survive in the wild. So they are truly unreleasable animals. The third point, which is relevant here, is that we do need suitable release areas to release orangutans, not just these orangutans, but all of them. And as long as release areas are missing, as long as the forest is destroyed in Indonesia, we will always have difficulties bringing animals back to the wild.
Mm. Yeah, it's such a complex issue, these poor orangutans. And now back to you, Aaron. Speaking of goals, what has been your driving? You've made it through 4 years of nothing less than hell, having to document this horrendous industry. What is your goal for this documentary? What would be success for you with this documentary?
I think the goals, there are kind of multiple layers, because when you're fighting for an issue like this, or when you're working in conservation, there's no one answer to it. You know, you have to work with multiple stakeholders, whether it's the facilities themselves, governments, tourists, the wildlife poachers. I mean, there's so many different layers involved. One of the major goals is just to, and I hope this doesn't sound kind of too generic, but it's just to get people to think twice before visiting these places. Because all the data and all the studies show that people don't want to cause harm to animals, particularly wildlife tourism attractions. I think studies show that, you know, 90% of people don't want animals to come to any harm in these places. You've got to worry about the other 10% of people. I mean, what do they want? So what we want to do is we just want to place that seed of doubt in people's mind when they're visiting, to say, oh, well, where are the orangutans coming from? Mm. Or actually, did you know that orangutans, they're not native to Thailand, but actually they're coming from the jungles of Indonesia and Malaysia? Or did you know that orangutans are actually very solitary animals and they shouldn't be in groups with other individuals? Or did you know that orangutans are arboreal, so they live in the treetops? So to see them sprawled on the ground at a wildlife tourism attraction is very unnatural behavior. So it was really interesting when we were at some of these places, we posed these questions to the tourists, and you could see them thinking about it in their mind and actually kind of questioning themselves and questioning their decisions. And once they had that in their mind, they were actually, oh yeah, you know, maybe this isn't great what we're seeing, or maybe we shouldn't be visiting these places. But it's just kind of a combination of ignorance, apathy, selfishness, you know, social media, that need or that desire for that social media shot that is driving these industries. So if we can just get people to think twice, to be asking themselves these questions before visiting these establishments, then I think that's part of our job. Done. Anyway.
Perfect answer. And we hope everyone takes that to heart, because that's how we will shut down this industry. So thank you, Aaron. And lastly, to Sophia. So we've just talked about what humans can do, but what is truly needed to save the species? And then, of course, how can people help in that cause to help us save the orangutans?
Yes, there's no simple quick answer to that. But to save the species, you need true conservation. And that means you cannot just only focus on the species and the orangutans themselves. Of course, they are the ones that need to be rescued and rehabilitated and released. And for all of that, we need support, and we need to improve our release efforts to make sure that in the future we do have wild-born babies and can establish new wild populations. That's one part of it, to ensure that the species can survive. But I think, in general, in order to conserve the species, we need to conserve its habitat, and that's the main problem with the orangutan. It's one of the best protected animal by international as well as national law. So law enforcement is a problem and needs to be improved. But its habitat is not protected, and that's the problem, especially in Borneo. In Sumatra, we just have relatively few Sumatran orangutans who are still living there, but they fit into the protected areas. In Borneo, it's the other way around. Around 80% of the Bornean orangutans, they do live in forests that are actually can be cut down at any time, and they don't stick to the borders of national parks. So that's the reason why they are critically endangered, because so many of them live in areas where they are not, cannot be protected very well. So securing land, securing forests, making sure that the forest that is still there and the wild populations do survive is really key. And we do need the forest, as I mentioned already, also to release rehabilitated orangutans. So saving the habitat in combination with educating the people surrounding those release areas, surrounding rescue centers, as well as the international audience listening to today is important. And all of that plays together and all of that is needed, I think.
Yeah, and of course we know there's so many issues facing orangutans, and this what's showcased in the documentary, the legal wildlife trafficking. I mean, it's just one of many threats to orangutans, and we need to shut all of these avenues down. So thank you both. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but I really appreciate you guys taking the time to talk with everyone, and we're so excited by this documentary. So thank you both. It's been a real pleasure. And with that, we're going to wrap up. What an incredible documentary, and what an incredible documentary filmmaker in Aaron. We're so proud to be partnering with him. So if you want to see the full documentary, you have one opportunity right now to do so, and that is this Sunday, August 22nd. And there are two screening times. So if you go to the website eyesoftheorangutan.com, again, eyesoftheorangutan.com, you can look at those two screening times, and hopefully one of those will work for your time zone. And also, as Aaron said, this is 4 years of blood, sweat, and tears for him and his team to put this together. It's a work of passion. But that passion won't be converted to change without you, without me, without everybody sharing this documentary with the world. And right now, the only opportunity we have is to do that this Sunday. We hope to get it into other networks in the future, but right now, this is all we have. So I put it to every single person watching to share this documentary, this website, on your social networks, share it in your personal networks, share it anywhere you can, so we can get the word out, and we can get many millions of people watching this documentary to be able to create the change. Because once you know better, you do better. And once you see this documentary, you can only do better. And Aaron talked about many of the other ways in which we can do that. So we really, truly hope that Eyes of the Orangutan is the documentary that finally puts an end to this illegal wildlife trafficking of orangutans. And that can really only happen with your help. So please do so now. And with that, it wraps up our International Orangutan Day 2021 event. We hope you enjoyed it. We hope it was informative. We hope we had you enjoyed the fun videos of our adorable orangutan jungle school, orangutans being orangutans. And from me at Boss UK and all of our Boss partners, we thank you for the support that you give us day in and day out to allow us to continue to do our work. We will not rest until orangutans are saved forever in perpetuity, and we are no longer seeing orangutans on the endangered species list. Even then, we're going to continue to protect them, because they deserve to live here just as much as any of us. And if we don't act swiftly and we don't act now, we will lose them. We will lose them in our lifetime. And that is a reality that none of us ever want to face. So thank you for tuning in. Thank you for supporting. And if you do want to support any of the Boss partners, you can go to orangutanfreedom.org. Again, orangutanfreedom.org. And you can link to any of our Boss partners. All of the money from any Boss partner funnels to our work in Indonesia. So thank you. It has been a real pleasure. And with that, I will say good night.